Sometimes, on a summer evening, when the tourists have gone home and the town is quiet again, I'll shut up shop and take a walk around the old place, down Castlegate, past the little house on the corner where I stayed as a child. And I'll remember. Around every corner of this town, the planes of time converge. The sound of a military band striking up in Buckingham Square chases away the ghostly echoes of a cheering crowd along Bridge Street. Rallying cheers for parading soldiers who carry our last hope of freedom as they march out of Helmsley and to war. I can almost hear the haunting neigh of the horses being assembled for the first war as I pass Barker's yard, where Anthony's father ran the town stables. And as I reach the marketplace, I can still see in my mind's eye the shadow of my own elusive father standing on the steps of the Earl of Feversham's monument, commanding his battalion. And then all too quickly, he is gone again. I stop momentarily and look around me. Not much has changed since I came here as a lad. The impressive sandstone buildings still sit four square and content around the pretty marketplace. Only the names above the shop doors tell you this is 1995, not the 1940s. But how different life was back then. The threat of invasion, never far from our game playing and childish conversations, as we youngsters try to somehow make sense of a changing world.
So, they say France has fallen?
Yep, they've taken Paris. It's only a matter of time now, Father says. Although, we're living in a garrison, we are, if you look around.
Actually, it's a fortress town. We're seeing many of these fortress towns. Mr. Church has built them every 20 miles or so up the
coast.
Well,
that's because he's sure that if Germany invades, they'll come in our coast, here.
I mean, there's concrete blocks on all the roads coming into Helmsley, so only little cars can get through, but the German tanks can't get through.
And all the walls are made double thickness and a flat top, so they can get the guns on top. All the way round the town.
Then there's Edmund Wares, of course.
The saddler, on Castlegate. What's he
parked
got to do with?
Parked at the side of his saddlery is a whole series of tram lines, railway lines, cut into bits about, well, about 8 foot long.
8 feet long?
Haven't you seen them? And near them are some holes in the ground. So if we get invaded, Home Guard will lift the lids off and put these iron rails in these holes and stop the tanks coming into Helmsley.
Don't be daft. How's bits of rails sticking out the ground going to stop German tanks?
I don't know. Maybe that's the best the Home Guard can come up with. Sticks in holes.
No, no, listen. Because, well, ours is the first house in Ashdale Road and our window looks straight out onto the Northern Road. And the Home Guard turned up the other day with a huge machine gun, this big, wanting to put it on our landing windowsill so they can shoot up the road, shoot up the enemy coming in from Norton.
They didn't.
They did. Mother nearly dies. She nearly dies when they bring this machine gun. My goodness, the Home Guard don't half get it in the neck. She says, if one of you lot's shooting from my window and there's a line of enemy tanks coming, we'll be the first to get a shell. They'll put the first shell in our house.
And did it stop them?
Of course not. They're the Home Guard, aren't they? They can do what they like. And anyway, I'm glad they took no notice of Muller. I'm glad we've got a machine gun. I mean, last night, after they were saying on the wireless that France had
fallen?
Father, he's talking to my mother and looking dead serious, he is. And he's saying, you know we're in trouble here now. He's saying, they're going to do for us. They're going to come. And that's what he said. I mean, my dad's seen the First World War right through. And they won that, won it. They didn't surrender. But now he's saying we're in trouble this time. His face was dead serious. It was dead serious.
It's strange when I try to imagine my father's face. I can't really remember what he looks like. I can't quite make out his face. I close my eyes, try to imagine him, but it seems such a long time since I've last seen him. Anyway, Even if your dad is right and they're going to come in from the North Sea, Mr. Churchill says we're going to fight them, and not only on the beaches, but in our streets.
And in our field.
And we'll never surrender. So there. Here, should we go to the top of Baxton Road and watch the troops doing bombing practice over Bransdale?
Go on, then.
There was such a freedom to our childhood, despite the darkness of war. We had the run of the town and of Duncan Park, and although soldiers were stationed there, we'd still roam around the park after school, see what was going on, play by the river, catch rabbits, and generally poach. It was our playground, Duncan Park. Soldiers didn't bother us if we didn't bother them. Aye. There was a freedom to a wartime childhood in the country, especially for me, a young lad from the city.
They've been bombing London for 56 days now, so they said on the wireless. 56 days in a row.
56 days and nights.
And nights, yes.
Today will be the 57th.
We're seeing more evacuees because of it, right enough. They're leaving London.
And Middlesbrough.
Like rats from a sinking ship this time, sitting on the steps of the Earl of Feversham's monument they are. They always sit on the steps, our evacuees. Did you sit on the steps when you arrived?
Nah.
You're an evacuee though, aren't you?
Sort of.
From London?
That's right.
You've been here a long time now. You must have been here, ever so long.
Been here a whole year. Come up last year when they bombed the East End, where Granny lives. Hitler, he's saying he's going to turn it into a pile of rubble. Set the whole place on fire. And next thing I know, Mother has me at the train station and she's saying I have to wear a label and not lose Teddy.
Did it have your name on it, the label?
That's right. And it said, proceeding to Miss Holston, that's my aunt, by the way, Castlegate, Helmsley, York. I've still got the label, actually. And I was holding my Teddy. I had Teddy under my arm and I had a little bag. Train was full of soldiers, full of troops, people in uniform. It was a big passenger train with a corridor, you know, packed full of troops.
Oh, the trains and buses are always full of troops now.
The Reliance bus, when it comes in from York, heaving it is, troops.
Weren't you frightened being on your own, on the train?
I don't think so. Not at the time. I was excited, I think. You know, it was a kind of adventure. And I know I'm going to be met at this end by someone who knows me. I don't know them, mind. But they know me. Not like some of these evacuees we get who come and have nowhere to go and they're just housed out in various places. No, I was excited.
Father lands home the other day with an evacuee.
You've got an evacuee?
And a mucky little beggar he is. Father took pity on him because he's the last one sat on the steps. Brought him home and, oh Lord. He wets the bed, his nose runs, and Mother's having five fits. What on earth have you brought him home for? He'll have nits and everything. Straight in the tin bath she had him. Gave his nose a firm wipe and straight in the tin bath. She despairs of him.
Doesn't sound like he'll stick around long.
They don't last long, do they? Most of these evacuees. Not like you. Never been in the country before, some of them. Don't like it. So they pack up and go home, back to the bombs.
Back to the bombs and rations. At least we eat healthy.
How do you mean?
Compared to people in towns and cities.
Right.
We have game, we have rabbit, we have eggs, we have milk, we have pig kill.
We have pig kill. We always keep a pig in our stable yard. Yep.
And it's a big day, is pig killing.
It lasts us through the year.
Yeah, you see, there's no... I mean, it is short as food. But we feed very well.
Well, in the country, you know, we grow our own vegetables in the garden.
You catch rabbits and then there's pheasants.
Rooks! Rook pie! And you keep a pig, hams and sides of bacon, that sort of thing. And fish.
Catching fish for your supper.
No, they come in a box, our fish.
In a box?
Fishy Swift sends us a box of fish nearly every month, he does. He's a big trawler man in Hull, is Fishy Swift. And he has three sons and, We got the eldest, Nigel, come to live with us, a bit like an evacuee, you know. And every month, this box of fish arrives, and Mother all in her to do to try keep it fresh.
Why do you think he sends you so much fish?
Because I think Fishy Swift pays Dad for keeping his son, Nigel. He pays him in fish, and Mother's like, come here, you mucky beggar, and straight in the tin bath with him.
Hang on. Is this the same little lad your father found on his own on the old steps?
Oh, no. That one's not from Hull. He's from...
Middlesbrough?
He's from... I don't know where he's from, but he has a teddy bear overcoat and his nose is always running. Lucky little beggar. Why Father had to bring him home, we'll never know. Your dad go visit you when he gets his leave?
How would I know?
Haven't you heard from him then?
What's it to you if I have?
All right, was only asking. Here! Fancy playing soldiers in those great holes the Home Guard have dug all along the side of the town. Can pretend we're in the trench. Boom!
They're not holes, they're tank traps, silly.
Well, are you coming?
Go on, then.
This November evening, my stroll takes me in a different direction. Past the little house on the corner of Castle Gate, where I lived with my aunt all those years ago, and into Duncan Park itself. From my bedroom window, I had a clear view into the camp. The low autumn sun would catch the corrugated roof of steel Nissan huts hidden in the trees, sending flashes of light like Morse code messages. And at all times, there was a movement of people coming and going, coming and going. And an observant little boy watching them, unnoticed.
Seen the huge red glow last week where Hull was getting blasted to death.
Oh, and what about Teesside? Did you see the skies alight over there?
Oh, Teesside have been getting it all right. We sit at the window watching me and Father.
Bet you don't have as good a view as me. I have a bird's eye view here from my aunt's house. See all sorts, not only in the skies, but down on the ground. And all day and night is the movement of people. And I watch them from up here, from my bedroom window, coming and going.
What, even in the blackout?
Yes, even in the blackout. Because we black out all the windows now. We have to, because one night, PC Bradley's knocking on the back door, shouting at Anne, put that light out or I'll have you arrested. So we black out all the windows now. Anyway, sometimes in the middle of the night, when the house is all dark, I peek through the curtains and guess what I see?
What?
I see soldiers outside our house in the middle of the night, right outside our house. And do you know what they're up to? What they're after?
Go on.
You know our pear tree?
The one in your garden?
The soldiers come in at night, when they've been drinking, this is, and they throw a thunder flash into the pear tree and blow all the pears off. So we wake up and they boom and this thing goes up and all the pears blow off and then... Down come the military police from the park and they...
Oh, the military police are forever in the town. I mean, there's on average 2,500 troops up here, Father says, up the park and...
That's right. They come and meet in Helmsley Market and...
They drink the pubs dry. There's fights and scuffles outside pubs. Father says the pubs are having a job getting beer to please them.
Yeah, and so these chaps come down in their jeeps from Duncan Park with their white helmets on and going and bonking people on the head.
Regimental police. No, military police.
Bonking people on the head in the middle of the night for fighting.
And blowing pears off trees. Boom!
So you see, I'm an observer, me. I like to observe. I keep my eyes open, notice what's going on around me. For instance, I can tell you that any minute now, our neighbour will come out of his house and head to town. Every Friday, he sets out for the King's Head at 10 o'clock sharp. Every Friday, 10 o'clock in the morning without fail. And I bet when you see him, you think he's just some poor old man, like all the other old men around here. But he's not. He's a hero.
What? Old Jim Dale, who lives next door?
Fought in the Somme, First World War, won a military medal.
A military medal? Really? What for?
Don't know, but they say he's a hero.
God, Never knew that. Jim Dale, the old gamekeeper.
My father's won a military medal, actually, in the First War.
Never.
He did. He was in the infantry. Some kind of medic, I think.
You mean a stretcher bearer?
Perhaps.
You should ask him what he got it for, your dad.
Maybe, if I ever get the chance.
Still not come home, then?
Only once.
He'll get leave again.
Maybe.
Don't you want him to come home?
I don't know. Sometimes I feel almost frightened of him coming home now.
Frightened?
Because my mother and my aunt, I've noticed they've started to... I don't know, almost they've started to have a dislike of my dad.
What do you mean? They don't like your dad?
Because he doesn't come home much now he's a soldier, because he has to spend most of his time abroad now. But he did come home last Christmas, and we got a tree. On our piano, actually, it was. And they spent ages putting this Christmas tree up, Mum and Aunt, with all the glass ornaments on it. And then comes my father in his uniform, because he's with the Shindits now, you know, helping the Gurkhas. And then he comes all proud in his smart uniform, and the Christmas tree falls off the piano and all the glass ornaments break. It wasn't funny. Mother spent the whole of Christmas blaming him for it, for the tree falling off the piano. And she keeps saying things like he'd rather be married to the army than to her.
People can't marry the army. That's daft.
She says he'd rather spend time polishing his uniform than being with us.
Well, he's a soldier. He has to polish his buttons.
I know, but his mother says he'd rather spend time...
Hey, isn't that the American soldiers we met last week down there? Come on. Might get some sweets. Yanks always give us gum when they see us. Hey, want some gum, Charlie?
Says Father rather spend time polishing his uniform than being with me.
A gentle autumn breeze brushes my face as I walk through the park gates. Up on my right was where the Naffy canteen stood, where my mother worked when she finally came to join me that Christmas. I remember the sound of Victor Sylvester on the wireless, the clatter of plates and the low thrum of men's voices through the open door. To my left, next to the river, the soldiers would be washing the wagons and the tanks on the concrete base, pumping the water from the river itself. And further up the driveway, just below the temple, stood the magical Garrison Theatre, where we children excitedly queue to watch films and Pathé newsreels on a Saturday night.
Did you see that newsreel about some new kind of bomb they dropped on London the other day?
The flying one? The one with wings?
Destroyed people's homes, killing them it did. Just when we thought the raids were a thing of the past.
Oh, we always have to go down into the air raid shelters when I visit Granny in the East End. As soon as the sirens blow, when there's bombers coming, we go under the table shelter, a Morrison shelter it's called, and me, being the smallest, they always make me go in first. And then everybody else piles in after me, you know, six or seven of them big, big, big old East End women, packed like sardines under this table shelter, and me squashed at the other end. And then when the bombing stops, we all come out one after the other like rabbits out of a hole.
We haven't got one of those table shelters, but that's because we never get bombed in Helmsley, do we?
We do. They did.
Well, they strafed Duncan Park once.
They strafed it once. They strafed the railway line. They
bombed Wombleton, where the Canadians are. They dropped a landmine on it because I remember my dad was kneeling on the bed looking through the window shouting, "Come on," at the bombers, and I was only 5 or 6, and they dropped this landmine and it went yow. You know, you could feel the blast 2 miles away. Father and I went backwards, did a double somersault off the bed. My father was laughing his frock off, you know, laughing away. He's seen it all before, of course, in the first one. Didn't you say your father fought in the first one?
Joined up when he was just a kid, lied about his age or something. He was only 14, living in the East End he was. They were very poor, so he joined up.
My father was a bugler in 1916. Somme, Ypres, Passchendaele, he did the lot.
My father was at Somme, but I don't know if he played his flute there. and I had an uncle who was killed in the First World War. A mother says he used to come home on leave covered in lice.
When my father was at Passchendaele, his mother, my grandmother, died, so he got compassionate leave. 4 days he got to come back to her funeral. They say he walked up from the station, and it's a fact that he was covered in mud, covered in lice. And as he walked up the street from the station, they are just bringing his mother's coffin out.
My father never speaks about it, the First War.
No. My father only talks about it on Armistice Sunday. He carries the standard for the British Legion. And, they all have a lot of drinks afterwards. And, he comes home and sits in the armchair in the kitchen. And all us kids sit around and he weeps. Proper weeps. Talking about all his friends, you know? How you have a group of friends. Like, we have a group of friends, and they were all killed, every one of them. He was the only one that came home.
The trouble is, I don't think my mother and aunt understand. They don't understand what's going on. They don't understand war. I mean, we have the troops here. We're outnumbered by troops. We're practically living in an army camp. Helmsley's pretty much an army camp. There's so much going on, and there's all these newsreels at the Garrison Theatre showing what the troops are facing, like in Burma and all these strange places. But they don't seem to understand the pressure the soldier's father must be under. It's like they're angry with the army and with my dad. Like he's done something wrong, like he has a choice. The way they speak about him, it just makes everything... It's like a black cloud hanging around our kitchen, waiting to burst. And I'm supposed to go along with it. I'm just supposed to go along with it.
I head off the main driveway and along the path towards the river, where we played as children, toward our meeting place. It's the 11th of November today. Armistice Day. This is the river where I first learned to fish and to build dams. I was fishing that time Mother came to find me, shouting to come quick. Father had arrived unexpectedly in the marketplace. I ran all the way, the sound of the marching band calling me. And, oh, the feeling of pushing my way through the crowds and then seeing him, standing on the steps of the Earl's Monument with the whole town watching as he commanded his battalion as they beat the retreat. The giant plumes on their hats waving in time as they marched one way up the square and then the other. Even my mother came into the market to watch him, and she whispers, "Why don't you go and stand with your father?" But of course I didn't. Even as a young boy, I'd got more sense than to do that. To go and stand next to this man, a man who had left the East End slums as a boy and against all odds become a regimental sergeant major of the Liverpool Irish King's Regiment Chindits. To go and stand next to him as he commanded his men? I had more sense than to do that. So I just watched with everyone else, blended into the crowd. And then as quickly as he came, he was gone again. Back to the fighting. Back to war.
So, Paris has been liberated, they said on the wireless.
Yep. Con, Paris, the Allies are taking France back bit by bit.
I'll never forget, you know, on the Pathé newsreel, when we saw all the tanks landing on the beaches. Some of our troops would probably have been amongst them, you know, from the camp at Duncan Park.
There's hardly any troops left here now. It's so quiet.
Even the evacuees are gone, most of them. All except you. Can't get rid of you. But at least we still have film night on a Saturday night.
My favourite part of the weekend, queuing up outside the Garrison Theatre.
We get all films, don't we? Laurel and Hardy.
All the shoot-em-ups, cowboys and that.
Entertainment for the troops.
All the stars of Enza.
Flanagan and Allen. We had the King visiting. Was it this year or last year? And all those other Digney Watsits.
I've stood this side of Bridge Road many a time, and from the station up I've walked Montgomery, Churchill and the King.
And the Queen and Princesses.
And I thought, when I saw them, even though I'm just a boy myself, I thought what little people they are, not much bigger than us.
Well, they aren't that big, actually.
Except Montgomery. Montgomery's tall, but Churchill and...
Churchill's big.
Churchill was...
But the King and the Queen, they're quite small.
Yeah.
And the Princess Elizabeth, she's not very big.
And the parades. What about the parades?
Oh, the parades.
You know, sometimes we get the whole army come marching down here in the middle of the night. They march down out of the camp if they're going abroad or wherever they're going. And they come down with a band, a big band, outside our house. The band strikes up. It wakes me right up, it does. 2, 3, 4 in the morning. And they march all the way around Helmsley to the station. And they're big bands. I mean, there's the Coldstream Guards.
And the Irish Guards.
And the Scots Guards. And when the Scots Guards were here, it was all bagpipes at 3, 4 in the morning. Get up out of bed and watch them because it's a full, full army parade.
Oh, all us kids love watching the parade.
Yeah.
Especially on Armistice Sunday with all the troops and soldiers and...
Yeah, it's a good parade on Armistice Sunday, seeing the old soldiers.
Here, I asked Father about old Jim Dale. Turns out he was a sniper in the First War. The old Earl in the First World War, this is. He formed his own battalion and took all his men from Duncan Park with him to war, including Jim Dale, the gamekeeper. And the old Earl, well, he was killed. My father told me the story. He says he shouted, "Come on, men, follow me." And, you know what he got?
A shot.
Right through his head. And he was laid out in no man's land for days and days. And the Germans heard this, that there was a high-ranking officer laid out, you know, an English colonel. And Jim Dale, along with 4 others, went out into no man's land, searching for him, and they brought his body back. That's how he got awarded a medal.
The military medal?
For bravery, for risking his life. He sent the Earl's horse. What's his name?
You mean Mustapha?
Mustapha, that's right. He sent the Earl's horse back and he's buried in the, under a tree, by the river, near the Cascades, in Duncan Park. They buried him under a tree and his headstone says, Mustapha, 1916. And so that's why Jim Dale got awarded the military medal.
My father was awarded the military medal and it's been mentioned in dispatches twice in this war.
Really? What for?
Don't know.
He must have done something very brave. You should ask him when he comes home.
If he ever comes.
You should ask him. If he's been mentioned in dispatches, he's done something brave. Think about it. What if you asked him and he told you what he had done and it was really heroic, like in the pictures, or like old Jim Dale? Ask him.
It wouldn't have been anything.
And then,
like...
you can tell me all about it. And you can tell your mother.
She wouldn't be interested.
You can say, listen, mother, about father.
She wouldn't care.
Listen, you can say...
I'm telling you, she wouldn't...
Did you know he's a hero, mother?
It wouldn't make any difference.
Well, in any case, you can still tell me what he did.
Perhaps. Let's not talk about him anymore.
Here. Shall we go up to Atkinson's shop in the market square, get ourselves some fizzy lemonade?
Go on, then.
The sun is setting over the hill when I finally reach our meeting place. The ancient tree near the river. Nothing has changed here over the 50 years since we made our childhood pact. The sound of cascading water rushing hastily past, the bird's song, the shadow of breeze-blown branches still dance on the grass. Even the broken headstone carved with the words, Mustapha, 1916, sits patiently guarding with dignity the magnificent horse who lies beneath. All just the same as I remember. And I know that when we get together again, Anthony and me, even though 50 years have passed, we'll still be those 2 little boys, bonded by a shared childhood in war. and he'll still be asking me that same question that I struggled to answer as a child. Who is your father? Paint me a picture of this shadowy man.
So, it's over. So they said on the wireless last night.
The war in Europe, yep.
Japan will soon follow, they hope.
They've been celebrating all night in Trafalgar Square. We went down to London, Mother and I, and we've only just got back.
We had a party in the market square and I let out a cheer.
I suppose things will change round here now. Now there's not going to be an invasion.
They're already taking down a machine gun down from our landing window.
They'll be dismantling the Naffy in the market square next.
No more bombing practice over Bramsdale.
No more bagpipes striking up at 4 a.m.
Or pears being blown out of trees with thunder flash.
They'll probably remove the concrete blocks on all the inroads.
And they'll put the town's name back up at the station.
There'll be no sign the military were ever here.
Reckon they'll dismantle the garrison theatre.
I guess.
No more going to the pictures on a Saturday.
Have to go to York if we want to see the pictures.
At least the bus won't be packed with troops.
Aye, we won't know the place.
Here, what do you think it'll be like in 50 years from now? I'll be 59.
We'll be 60.
I wonder what it'll be like. What do you think it'll be like? What will we be like? We should meet up in 50 years' time, wherever we are in the world. We should come back to Helmsley and meet up.
In 50 years' time, on Armistice Day, we'll meet right here in Duncan Park.
By the gates? No, near the river.
Near the part of the river they call the Cascades.
Yes, under the tree, at Mustapha's grave.
What do you think we'll talk about?
Oh, I don't know. We'll talk about our work, I expect, and our wives, and boring things like that. And we'll talk about our war, our childhood, and all the games we've played here in the park. And about our fathers in the First World War. And, I don't know, maybe I'll ask you about your father. I'll ask you what became of your father when this war ended.
And I'll say that he disappeared after the war. Disappeared completely. And that it wasn't till 30, 40 years later that he got in touch. Found me again. How I got a letter from him, wanting to know where we were, what we were doing, and all about us. And that he was living in Manchester. And I'll tell you how I think he had a rough time when he came out of the army. How I think he's almost been down and out.
How I think he is suffering from what they will later call post-traumatic stress disorder. Going through one war, the Somme, so young, and then through Burma when he was no longer young. And how war and the army chewed him up and spat him out, and how it left him, a man in his late 40s without any direction, out on Civvy Street looking for work. And I'll talk about how he goes on to become a Chelsea pensioner. And how one day I walk into a gallery in Mayfair. And there he is, my father, in this posh gallery. His face in charcoal framed. Hanging between a portrait of Maggie Thatcher and Douglas Fairbanks, or some film star or other. How a famous artist called Sarah Layton went to Chelsea Hospital and picked him from all the Chelsea pensioners. And how she drew that face that I struggled so hard to remember as a child. And how, well, I visit him regularly at the Chelsea Hospital. And we have quite a good time, oh yeah. And we, well, how it almost makes up, not the lost years that we had, but how it makes up for some of the years we'd never known each other. And that it's good now. It's good.